I'm very happy to introduce tonight's speaker, who's Michele Sorice, who is a professor of deliberative democracy and new technologies in the Department of Political Science at Lewis in Rome. Lewis is the, I never remember what it stands for, Libera Università Internazionale di Studi Sociali. Okay, Lewis. And before that, he taught for several years at the University of Rome La Sapienza in the Department of Communication Science. And at Lewis, he also directs a research center, the Massimo Baldini Center for Media and Democratic Innovation. He coordinates a think tank called Innovazione Democratica, New Democracy, and he's a member of the Participatory and Deliberative Democracy Group of the Political Studies Association. As all this might indicate, he's very interested in the question of democracy and what is called deliberative and participatory democracy, and I'm sure that he will talk about that in his lecture. He's a prolific public speaker and writer, author or co-author of more than 20 books. Makes me I produce a book perhaps once every 8 years. Michele seems to produce one every 8 minutes, maybe every 8 months more. And he's also author of over 70 articles and book chapters. And the particular focus of his work, particularly over the last 5 years, has been on democracy and the sort of political dimensions of communication. So he's particularly well qualified to speak on this subject. If I can just say one more thing before I let Michele speak. I've been teaching myself courses on media in Italy and in Europe for the last 25 years, I guess, to students in the UK and now more recently in the US. Every time I begin a new course, I'm confronted by a number of stereotypes, people's perception of what Italian media are in relation to democracy, whether you're teaching a course on the fascist period or the post-war period, is very kind of constrained along certain conventional channels. The basic narrative goes like this, that there's never really been a fully democratic media system in Italy. It's always been hijacked by one or other political party. And then for the last 30 years or so, it's been dominated by a public service channel that's heavily connected to parliament and government, and on the other hand, by one dominant entrepreneur who has been 4 times prime minister and hasn't yet left the political scene. So, you know, that's the kind of standard picture, I suppose, a kind of non-fully democratized media system. I think the reality is actually quite a lot more complicated than that, and I think that a lot of that, of course, is true, and I'm sure Michele will talk about that. But the other side is there's been a lot of space for innovation, for democratic forms of communication, blogs, websites, social media. So the picture is actually much more variegated than many people think, and I think we're going to get an introduction to that this evening. So please welcome Michele Sorice.
Thank you for the invitation, Professor Edelstein, Professor Forget, and Claudia Tarallo. Thank you very much. We have a few time, so I can introduce immediately the topic we speak about this afternoon, this evening. There is a growing evidence of public disillusionment with institutions of the advanced industrial democracies. The decline in electoral turnout, low levels of trust in politicians and political institutions, and decline in membership of traditional mobilizing organizations such as political parties and trade unions are just some expressions of the growing disconnection between citizens and decision makers. Russell Dalton, a US leading and influential authority on political attitudes and behavior, argues, "By almost any measure, public confidence and trust in and support for politicians, political parties, and political institutions has eroded over the past generation." In the same time, we can easily say that participation that goes beyond voting is one major component of the so-called good democracy. Good democracy is a strange expression. Joining political parties, taking part in discussion about political matters, communicating with representatives, protesting, and engaging in local politics are political activities that contribute to the democratic quality of a political system, as Diamond and Morino stated in an influential book published in 2005. While party membership is declining and citizens become more and more disenchanted with traditional forms of participation, democratic innovations give citizens the opportunity to influence political decision-making in an institutionalized setting of deliberative or direct democratic procedures. We can discuss about the difference between deliberative and direct democracy. Participatory practices such as deliberative polls, participatory budgeting, the different types of mini publics, and so on, have thus the potential to respond to deficits of the representative democratic system and thus contribute to its legitimacy. But we can also observe this situation using another perspective. According to Nadia Urbinati, for example, and in my opinion it's difficult to not agree with her statement, we should not be too quick in reading these mutations as a rebirth of direct democracy. Although they may be read as an assertion of the classical democratic ideal of power of the people, recent waves of anti-establishment contestations are different from what we have learned from previous revolutions. Those previous revolutions vindicated political autonomy and in its name questions the distribution of electoral power, such as, for example, in 1848, representation with free mandate in 1871, and electoral democracy more generally, like captained in 1968. But these recent waves of contestation of representative democracy do not vindicate political autonomy in the classical democratic style or as direct versus indirect power of the citizens to make decisions. Using Pierre Rosan Vallon's language, we may say that these new waves of contestation of constituted politics testify to a desire to check and monitor institutions and leaders, that is, to hold a negative kind power that reclaims judgment and inspection rather than a positive power that reclaims decision-making. It constitutes a sensorial inspection by the citizens whose aspiration is surveillance rather than self-governing. So, we have a problem, the loss of credibility and legitimation of traditional politics, and three different people's answers. The first one, the apathy. The second one, the demand for sensorial inspection of representative institutions. The third one, the request for new forms of political participation. The Italian situation is an extremely interesting case. I say it not only because I'm an Italian, of course. On the one hand, because of some similarities with most of the Western democracies. On the other hand, because of its unique structural characteristics. To understand the Italian specifics, we need to take three factors into consideration. The increasing importance of the executive and implicit change to the institutional setup. The electoral laws, and third, the role of the media, and in particular its relationship with the political leaders, first of all Silvio Berlusconi, but this relationship also involves other political leaders. The first incontrovertible factor has been the increasing importance of the executive, in the same way in Italy as in United Kingdom, Germany, France, and even in US, as Ludger Helms, a German scholar, wrote in a book about prime ministers and chancellors published in 2005, by Sage, I think. As early as the 1980s and especially in the 1990s, Italy too witnessed an increase in the importance of the executive in the decision-making process. Previously, the parliament had a central role in the system of government, but this role has been taken over by the executive, in particular with the introduction in Italy of the system of two political parties in competition with each other called bipolarism, starting with the 1996 elections. Please, pay attention to the fact that I'm highlighting that in Italy, bipolarism is different than bipartitism. Italy has a long tradition of hybrid bipolarism, for example, Catholics and Communists, during the so-called First Republic in a multi-party system. The Westminster model, for example, on the opposite, is theoretically based upon bipolarism and bipartitism. But also in the UK, the things are going differently. A coalition government at the moment and probably may have three or four polarism, I don't know. The conservatives and maybe the Lib Dem in the conservative poll, the UKIP, led by Nigel Farage as the main component of Eurosceptics and xenophobic forces, and a progressive poll represented by the Labour Party and the Scottish National Party, that, however, are not allied. And probably they will not become, at least considering the last Ed Miliband's words. So a different situation even for the country who gave the name to an electoral system, the so-called Westminster system. In effect, this change was no, in Italy I mean, was no small matter. The centrality of parliament in the system of consensual democracy, which characterized Italy before the 1990s, was effectively replaced by a majoritarian kind of pseudo-democracy. The transactional leaders were also low-profile figures of the pre-1994 governments, were replaced by transformational leaders. And within the parties, the new democratic prince assumed greater decision-making powers. A far from secondary feature in this process was the crisis of the traditional parties, victims of ideological realignment as well as of social change. National societies, which were organized around socio-economic divisions, those underlying the competitive democracies, or around ethnic or cultural divisions, those underlying the consensual democracies, were progressively dismantled, more the socio-economic than the ethnic cultural divisions, really. After this dismantlement, societies emerged that tended to be individualistic, organized around particular professional or social groups, generically amorphous in terms of their identity. In this context, it became difficult for the political parties to carry out their representative activity. They had to recognize that they were no longer the repositories of identity that pre-existed politics, and so they had to invent ways of promoting and redefining themselves. The principal solution was to trust in their leaders' capacity to gather consensus. Moreover, in Italy, the vacuum left by the traditional party system has been occupied not so much by new parties as by personal parties, or in any case, by the leaders' parties. The new centrality of the executive, together with electoral reforms, the second factor, significantly changed the institutional setup. Although, strictly speaking, no structural changes were made to the form of the state. In fact, today citizens still vote for their parliamentary representatives, not for the government. However, the 1993 electoral laws, the 1999 constitutional reform, which introduced the direct election of the heads of the regional governments, and the 2005 electoral reform, the so-called Calderoli law, recently declared illegal by the Constitutional Court, effectively changed the landscape. The result was a new form of government, which is not contemplated in a traditional legal or political literature. It is a form of mixed government, combining elements of presidentialism and of parliamentarism. It was defined as a neo-parliamentary system, but it could also be called, and in my opinion it's a better definition, could also be called a neo-presidential model with three main characteristics. One, a lesser, more directly elected head of the executive, the government. Two, an electoral system with a majority bonus. And three, belief in the saying stand together, fall together, as Roberto Dalli Monte stated in a very nice book published in 2011. In reality, if this is entirely the case for local government elections, it is not completely so for national elections, as Roberto Dalli Monte clearly notes. The head of the executive is not formally elected directly by the people, although the 2005 Calderoli law lays down that voters must express a preference for the head of the coalition or political force. In practice, This was already the case during the lifetime of the 1993 Mattarella Law. In this way, the Calderoli Law presented a very original situation. A de facto government that emerged from the ballot boxes as chosen by the voters, but by law, it remained a prerogative of Parliament to guarantee the government's majority and of the President of the Republic to appoint a Prime Minister. It is clear that this was a dangerous situation precisely because of the lack of any stable majority, a situation that is exacerbated by a legislature consisting of two chambers having the same prerogatives, as happened after the February 2013 general election. In essence, the mixture of an electoral system based on two parties and on parliamentarianism has provoked a short circuit which has, first and foremost, damaged the relationship of trust between the voters and their elected representatives, thus triggering a credibility crisis for the traditional parties. It should be noted that the 1993 electoral system was decidedly a majority one, although it did allow for a proportional share, and was based on the British plurality voting system. The 2005 mechanism, while maintaining the two-party idea, was instead a proportional system with a majority bonus and a closed list of candidates. This last and strongly contested electoral system has effectively created a parliament of nominees rather than elected representatives, in that it has removed any possibility for voters to vote for or express a preference among candidates. With the partial exception of the Democratic Party, which independently introduced a means of selecting candidates by holding primaries, both for the leadership and or the coalition, and for election candidates. But a similar situation seems ready to be reproduced by the so-called Italicum electoral law proposed by Mr. Matteo Renzi, with a situation even worse if we consider that the open primaries elections are permitting irregular results, as you can read in Italian newspapers, even in the last weeks. In this framework, political communication itself emphasized its commitment to promoting national leaders, even in local and peripheral context. This distance underlined politicians' reliance on opinion polls and the media's turning the elections into a show. The often populist tones used in election campaigns sometimes represent the structural necessity of an electoral competition, which has been transformed into a referendum about the leader or various leaders. This aspect is therefore very important and is fundamental to the third factor of the unique nature of Italy's political situation, the role of the media. The media, as you know, are a symbolic picture frame enclosing the elements that make up a new public sphere. The media-filled public space constitutes a crossover point, the control of which can guarantee, if not electoral victory, surely a large strategic advantage. The central position of the media in today's politics is not, of course, only an issue in Italy. The importance, first of the press, then of television, and still later of the internet in North American and British life is widely recognized. The Italian situation, in other words, is in some ways extraordinarily similar to that of other societies. A trend towards turning politics into a media show, reciprocal dependency between the media and the political system, interconnections between the agenda of the media and that of politics, interference in the private lives of political figures on the part of the press, the trend towards personalization and so on. At the same time, however, the Italian scenario has different and specific characteristics. The first is surely the cast iron links between the parties and national public TV and radio stations, the origins of which go back to the dawn of radio and is now deep-rooted thanks to the various laws reforming the state broadcaster RAI. In this regard, I suggest you a very interesting reading, a book published in 2006 by Eri, an Italian publisher Property of Rye, written by Matthew Hibbert, about the Italian broadcasting system. The second is a traditional structural weakness of publishing, which forced the mass newspapers to use public funds to ensure their survival. In this regard, another reading suggestion, a famous, very influential book, for me, it is like a Bible, a book published in 2000, written by David Forgash, about the industrialization of Italian culture. It's very interesting because it explains very well the situation. The third reason is undoubtedly the conflict of interest problem caused by the dual role of Silvio Berlusconi as party leader and later prime minister and as the owner of the largest media empire in Italy. Therefore, if some aspects of the media coverage of Italian politics are fully consistent with the situation in other European countries, others are completely original and are by no means secondary in understanding the role played by media in representing populist and anti-political feeling. The media provide a space favored by populist expression, which is often modeled on anti-political rhetoric. Donatella Campus reminds us that in political competition, the main vehicle of differentiation is the political language. So Donatella Campus, in a book about anti-politics in Italy, published in 2006. Which is, so Donatella Campus, at the same time, a crucial part of the construction of the identity of new social groups. Within the media, and markedly in that area of television programming, which is defined in Italy as telepolitics, telepolitica, anti-political rhetoric finds a strong resonance, which doesn't originate in television, but which finds in this medium an extraordinary breeding ground. Anti-politics feeds on the clash between us and them. It thus adopts a mechanism of ideological unification. In other words, anti-politics is absolutely ideological, even when it adopts discursive strategies against party ideology. But what about the democracy in Italy? The economic crisis has surely increased the adoption of anti-political rhetoric by populist leaders, as favored the loss of credibility of the traditional political parties, as underpinned the legitimation crisis of Italian democracy, a phenomenon that Leonardo Morlino, a very influential political scientist, defines disanchoring. Just about Morlino's theory of anchoring, let me say that to understand the weakness of the Italian democracy, we should also analyze the peculiar situation of the country, such as of a democracy without qualities, to use a Leonardo Morlino statement of 1998. According to the influential political scientist, and my colleague also, Italy continues to experience a problem of anchoring of its democracy. The Morlino's theory of anchoring suggests that democratic consolidation and crisis can be explained by the diverse and changing connections between legitimations and a few precise anchors. I think that, unfortunately, my opinion, of course, we do not have time to deal with this problem here, but it's obvious that we must also consider the structural weakness of Italian democracy to understand the impact that anti-politics and populism have on it and its processes. After this very long introduction, let me start again with three starting points. Summarizing, we can recognize three main causes of change in Italian politics. First one, the crisis of legitimacy or traditional politics based on political parties, which seem to lose their traditional role of intermediate bodies in a representative democracy. I don't like the expression intermediary bodies, because the word body puts in display a functionalist and mechanistic approach. I prefer expression as intermediary agents, but intermediary bodies is well attested in tradition of political science, so I will continue to use intermediary bodies, also if I don't like this expression. Theoretical backgrounds of the crisis of legitimacy of politics can be found in the concept of cognitive mobilization elaborated by Russell Dalton and of critical citizens that I find more interesting, which has been proposed by Pippa Norris. The increasing demand, second point, for popular participation and civic engagement. An example is represented by the rise of active citizenship, but also, partly, by the rise of five-star movement, whose meetup represents a diffused example of civic engagement. Please keep in mind that the concept of grillismo expresses a different idea than the political approach of five-star movement's militants. The first one belonged to the idea of sanctioning democracy. The second one is more connected with the idea of the spread of civic culture. Third point, the development of technologies and platforms that have facilitated some forms of political participation and active citizenship. Anyway, we cannot forget that contemporary democracies emerge as party democracies. Political parties, the key institutions of democratic governments, in the words of Richard Katz, have held a number of key functions in the governing process, including mobilization and channeling of support, formulation of alternatives, recruitment and replacement of leadership, and, when in power, implementation of policy and control over its administration. The end of the 20th century brought to light a number of problems and challenges for party governments, to the extent that Giovanni Sartori talked about the era of confusion of democracy. Kaza and Newton speak explicitly of crisis of democracy with reference to the disenchantment of citizens with political parties, the emergence of anti-party attitudes, and the growing incidence of more general dissatisfaction and anti-establishment attitudes. In such dissatisfied democracy, contemporary parties failed in performing their core representational and governmental functions linked to the transmissions of the political demand. The gradual disaffection of citizens in political life and the consequent decrease in the degree of social participation are accompanied by new types of relationships between parties and citizens. Peter Mayer, in 2002, introduced the expression partyless democracy, to stress the progressive erosion of ties or cleavages, in the words of Rocken, of parties' legitimations and rise of the plebiscitary model of leadership and representations. That led to the affirmation of political figures defined again by Sergio Fabbrini as democratic prince, whose personalization of power meant the shift of loyalty from parties to candidates and the consequent strengthening of the public role of the leader. The whole scheme of the political party, it's only an ideal type, of course. No parties has never functioning in this way, but in the political science theory, the mass party of the beginning of the last century is explained by these concentric circles. But now we have no longer the intermediary groups. We have only a connection, a linkage between the leader or the leaders and the electorate. This is a new plebiscitarian model that is bringing the political parties towards a new models of political parties itself, which we can call the presidential parties. In this context, we can frame the process of the presidentialization of political parties. This scheme shows the complex, the table shows the complex relationships which cooperate to determine the dissolution of the old parties and their organizational forms. And, in the same time, the emerging of the cartel party and then the liquid presidentialized party until the so-called franchise party. A new type, a new style of political party, which is very common now in Italy. The picture is a nice picture. The picture has not been taken in Italy, unfortunately. It is one of the crowded mass assemblies promoted by the Scottish National Party in Scotland. I think that this picture was taken in Dundee, if I well remember. Yes, Scottish National Party in Scotland. Apologies to the royal family, of course. I will speak about the Scottish National Party, but I will show you another image. This doesn't need explanation, I think. Not only democracy versus natural selection, but also the paradox of representative democracy. As Donatella della Porta, a famous colleague who teaches in the European Institute here in Florence, as Donatella della Porta noted, there is a general mantra of discussion on democracies and so-called empirical theories of democracy that democratic institutions are representative. The table puts in evidence the relationship between the forms of civic involvement, delegation or participation, with the mode of decision-making, majoritarian or deliberative. Crossing the two couple of variables, we find four models of democracy. From upper left, the traditional liberal democracy, towards the right, the participatory deliberative democracy. There is a contrast between the so-called exogenous and endogenous processes. Some visions of participatory democracy tend to consider the formation of collective identities as exogenous to the democratic process. That is, they emerge in the society and then participate in politics, as happened in the representative parliament. In the deliberative democracy, the preference formation and transformation during the discursive process is, on the opposite, considered a point of strength. Transformation of collective identities as endogenous to the democratic process. The transformations of collective identities are in the democratic process. Direct democracy is based upon an exogenous perspective of the democratic process, which is the main important difference between the so-called direct democracy, which is finalized to a vote, and the deliberative and participatory democracy, which is not exclusively finalized to a vote. In many political experiences, the rejection of delegation sometimes leads towards shifts in which the rhetoric of direct democracy becomes functional to the emergence of a paternalistic kind of leadership, as happened, according to many scholars, in the case of the Five Star Movement, whose parliamentary institutionalization coincided in practice with the revelation of a substantial internal democratic deficit, according to Bordignone and Ceccarini in a very famous article published in 2013. About Five Star Movement, anyway, we have to consider the substantive differences between its real constituency, based upon groups of civic engagement, and the vertical organization led by Beppe Grillo. In other words, the organizational adjustment of M5S seems to be based over a stratarchical organization. We can say similar things about the new presidentialized Democratic Party led by Matteo Renzi. The party's organization, in fact, seemed to be dictated more by desire to find, often through stratarchy-inspired solutions, balances in terms of access to resources or in terms or power relations among the party elites at various levels, and not to better respond to citizen demands and expectations. Of course, they are not the same things. As you know, deliberative democracy is based on the idea that the preferences of social actors can change during the course of the interactions. Deliberation is, so in the statement of Donatella della Porta, is based on horizontal communication flows, multiple producers of content, many occasions for interaction, confrontation on the basis of rational arguments, and a propensity to listen to the other side. In this sense, so Donatella Della Porta, deliberative democracy is discursive. From this perspective, the communicative force is not determined by how it is organized, but it is the main element giving structure to the motivation for political action. It is no coincidence, as said on several occasions by Donatella Della Porta and other scholars, that a deliberative democracy should be mainly based on consensual practices, in which leaving behind individual egoism is a precondition, as Hannah Arendt stated in the past, and solidarity as a real value in the implementation of the program. Deliberative and participatory democracy, in other words, goes behind the idea of the bourgeois public sphere in favor of a broader consideration of an alternative public sphere in which the mechanism of deliberation came into effect. The basic norms of participatory deliberative democracy are essentially the citizen empowerment and the political inclusion. So, not a sanctioning democracy, but a positive one. Not a sanctioning power, but a positive power. Speaking about the different models of democracy, we cannot forget to mention the role of the media, again, and in particular the growing importance of the Internet. The Internet is not responsible for the growth of civic engagement, and social media cannot make a revolution, as Gerbaudo wrote in a very nice book published 2 years ago, Tweets on the Streets, about the so-called Arabian Spring. But the media are certainly important for social participation, and pluralism in and of the media can facilitate the participation of disadvantaged groups. An important indicator, this is an important indicator, of the quality of democracy. At the same time, media democracy can also facilitate populist appeal. Populism is absolutely different from deliberative, participatory democracy. For Italian leaders, very important, and not only in Italy. For European leaders, my preferred leaders is the man on the top on the left, Nigel Farage, very intriguing and interesting man, problem for Europe. What can we say about democratic innovations? And what are the democratic innovations? Some keywords became very popular in the last decade. E-government, e-governance, open government, e-democracy, or digital democracy, as I prefer. E-government concerns the administrative functions of government, public administrations and institutions. These functions become transparent and more efficient through the adoption of digital technologies, and in particular, the Internet, whose governance thus becomes a strategic factor for the democratic functioning of the system. The so-called net neutrality is a very important question. E-governance, or also digital governance, refers to the process of rationalization of public administration and the change of philosophy in the relationship between state and citizens. Speaking about the e-government, the scientific literature is used to subdivide this concept into three different models. The first one is the so-called managerial model, whose main characteristics are the use of ICT as mere tool for information, the absence of a real interactivity, and the persistence of a top-down model of communication. The second one, the consultative model, is marked by a strong use of ICT as tools for the improvement of public policy, the presence of a partial interactivity, usually concerning only specific stakeholders, and a two-way communication model, although it remains in the control of public administrations. The third one is the participatory model. It is constituted by a broader interactivity, a dialogic communication model, and above all, the use of ICT as a tool to improve and qualify the democratic innovations. The open government is an hybrid and fluid concept, including e-government and e-governance, and only partially overlapping e-democracy. It can be defined using three variables with their specific dimensions that you can see. Transparency, participation, and collaboration. It's very similar to a definition that you can find in a document published in 2009 by the US administration, signed by Mr. Barack Obama, President of the United States of America, that you can find in the White House website. The open government, this is another formulation, another graphic formulation of open government as represented by the collective group Démocratie Ouverte, which is a French-speaking group connecting all the experiences about the open government and democratic innovations. Italy joined the open government partnership in September 2011 and changed three cabinets since then. Despite this change, some general trends can be detected and resumed in the second Open Government Partnership Action Plan, submitted at the end of 2014, which is organized in three groups of actions regarding transparency, participation, and digital development. The main goal of all transparency measures is accountability, particularly in the form of monitoring activities, follow the money, and fight to corruption, which is perceived as the worst Italian administration problem. It is perceived, and it is, probably. This conceptual framework is visible also in the passage of powers from the former Transparency Monitoring Authority to a more comprehensive anti-corruption agency. Renzi's government prevalently used a representative multi-stakeholders approach when drafting reform bills, often followed by an open consultation. This has been the case for the education reform, La Buona Scuola, the digital growth strategy, the public administration reform, although some important institutional reforms have only been discussed with parliamentary groups. Private actors and civil society organizations are involved in the implementation of the digital growth strategy, acceleration programs, so we called it, such as the diffusion of digital skills, the development of infrastructure and smart cities, which are meant to be pivotal for the full achievement of all other goals. A summary is schematically represented in the table on the previous slide. The e-democracy, or also digital democracy, as I prefer to define it, concerns the possibilities offered to citizens to affect the decision-making process. Its point of strength is represented not by technology, but by the deliberative process. But where are the origins, at least in Italy, of the democratic innovations? When we discuss about democratic innovations, we have to enlighten the role of the social movements. The way movements communicate constitutes a strategic asset. Communication is not, in fact, just an organizational tool, but it forms the cultural procedures through which the forms of participatory democracy are triggered. We are dealing here with a model that is completely different from those of the liberal democracies, at least from those resulting from the affirmation of neoliberal conception, which are based on an elitist vision of political participation. An elitist vision of political participation in the statement of Colin Crouch in a very influential book, Post-Democracy, published in 2003. In recent years, much research has concentrated on the relationship between the media and democracy. What is more, democratic institutions have been considered as independent variables, while the debate on the democratic potential of the internet is still confined to the study of the technological variables. I personally agree with Donatella Della Porta to define the movements as agents of democratic communication. In other words, they can be conceived as spaces for networking, including the gaining of experience both in international events, such as the World Social Forum, for example, and in more specific Italian context, which are capable of adopting a fully-fledged model of internal democracy that we could define as the open space method. Social media, in this perspective, represent important tools for connecting new experiences of political participation. They are usually used as accelerator of interest over some topics, such as human rights questions, or, more rarely, as a tool for counter-propaganda. But, first of all, they can, or probably they could, constitute important agents to improve the practices of democratic innovation, or at least to contribute to deliberative talk in macro-publics. The new communication technologies, in particular the Web 2.0, constitute an important set of tools and, at the same time, a symbolic representative space for the development and affirmation of new social movements. We certainly cannot say that the internet is responsible for the growth of the movements, just as we cannot say that social media alone can make a revolution, as I previously said. At the same time, however, we cannot but recognize the growing importance of the web, and more generally, of the media, in the development of new forms of democracy. The media, as correctly noted again by Donatella Della Porta, are certainly important for social movements, and besides pluralism in and of the media, can facilitate the participation and can represent an important indicator in the study of the quality of democracy, in as Leonardo Morlino did in the last 10 years. The media and the Web 2.0 in particular represent a central actor of the public sphere, but speaking about public sphere, we can no longer use the Habermasian model of 2006 that we can see now in the slide. It is consistent effectively with the potentiality of the Web 2.0, but it doesn't consider the power relationships that are anyway present in the public sphere. We should go beyond the dominant assumptions about nation-state organized publics and mass media consumption. There are new emerging personal network realities that link individuals across world regions in light global public space. New interconnected spaces in the frame of what Ingrid Faulkner defines communicative democracy. Social movements move in those alternative public spheres, which allow citizens to experience new forms of participation with an inclusive political logic. Let's go to the characteristics of democratic innovations. When we discuss the democratic innovations, we always find several problems of definition. I don't want to bother you reporting the points of contest among different scholars and schools. I prefer to ask you to focus your attention over a meeting point for the scholars, the seven variables that constitute the essence of every democratic innovation: the inclusiveness, the institutionalizations, the popular control, the legitimation, that means the legitimacy of citizen participation in political decision-making, ergo the rest of the capacity of citizens to make thoughtful and reflective judgments. At this level, the information procedures and the media's tools can represent an important way to empower legitimation of democratic innovations. The transparency, the efficiency, because participation, in other words, has not to limit to a virtuous action. It must achieve specific goals in terms of public policies. And transferability. As we should not forget, the complicated relation between collaboration and innovation. But I think that this is a topic for another lecture. What is happening in Italy? Not only politics, no. We have seen the crisis of an already weak democracy, but we have also seen the emergent form of civic engagement and political participation. In Italy, several different experiences of democratic innovations are developing. Some are highly institutionalized, others seem to represent experiments of new participation styles. All show the emergence of a popular willingness to be active citizens and to oppose social apathy. Several authors agree that citizen dissatisfaction is beginning to transpire. If voters' frustration is not necessarily caused by their dislike for policies, it is certainly provoked by their dislike for the method used to develop such policies. We can indicate different experiences in Italy, just designed to improve citizen participation and to better develop public policies. In this slide, I only mentioned some experiences, but of course there are many others. The law of the Tuscany region, this region, on civic participation, that represents one of the most advanced and effective among those currently in force in Italy. There are many practices of deliberative democracy in Trentino and Sardinia, in particular at city council level. Some city councils in Italy have adopted participatory budgeting. These experiences involve small towns, with the only partial, very partial exception of Milan. In other words, in Italy there are not yet examples of participatory budgeting such as achieved in Paris in 2014, the biggest city all over Europe using a participatory budgeting consultation. The Bologna regulation, of the commons is an experience of sharing governance concerning the care and regeneration of the urban commons. The Bologna regulation has been exported in some other cities, like Siena, for example. There are also examples of so-called sharing cities in the same frame of that adopted in Seoul. The most interesting case under this light is represented by Mantova. The project Comantova, for example, is a prototype of an institutionalized process to run cities as collaborative commons and therefore as co-cities, whereby urban, environmental, cultural, knowledge and digital commons are co-produced and co-managed collaboratively by five actors: social innovators, as for example the active citizens, public authorities, business organizations, civil society organizations, and knowledge institutions, such as, for example, universities, schools, cultural foundations, and so on. This happens through an institutionalized public-private people-community partnership. The tired relations between citizens and political parties seems to be balanced by the growth of new forms of participation. The discussion between, from one end, scholars who think that Italy is turning into an apathetic country, and, from the other hand, researchers who think that the change concerns only the way in which citizens are involved in public life, is, of course, open. It means that dissatisfaction with democracy is also a key point to explain the relationship between participation and political protest. But it is not a conclusive argument. Critic citizens are the most involved in the active citizenship, and form of e-participation, can be surely placed in the frame of intersection between active citizenship and innovative use of participatory digital platform. The case of Monza, basically focused over participatory budgeting, is interesting for innovative use of technology. You have the link, so if you want, you can click in the link. You can see the case of Monza, the Monza bipart.it. Anyway, it's however very different from Je m'engage, the Parisian platform for becoming solidaristic heroes. So the Municipalité Parisienne claims for the civic participation, in which the overlapping of civic engagement, active citizenship, and digital platform is clearly visible. At this stage, France is a step beyond Italy. The political parties are usually refractory to democratic innovation, and we can also add the lack of some features, such as the inclusiveness and the institutionalizations, makes it doubt even the fact that they can be counted among the forms of innovation. The same principle can be applied to the younger parties, usually caring with the new dynamics of participation. Anyway, experiences like Podemos in Spain, Syriza in Greece, or the Scottish National Party highlight the rise of new realities in institutional politics, with new organizational forms and methods, also taken by the realm of social movements. These represent a new space for democratic participation, as cited Podemos, Spain, Syriza, Greece, Scottish National Party in UK, oh sorry, in Scotland. The Italian cases are less intriguing, so I cannot cite any very really case of deliberative and participatory organization in Italy. To conclude now, we can say that Western democracies are facing new challenges. They must avoid to think in terms of control and fear. That is exactly what terrorist and anti-democratic forces want. The challenge is to go towards a dialogic democracy. It means to merge institutions of representative democracy, giving a new role to the intermediary agents who are to become more horizontal and openness-based, like, for example, Podemos or Syriza, with the use of participatory platforms in the frame of deliberative and participatory democracy. The merge of three aspects is the egalitarian democracy. The egalitarian democracy is a challenge, but also an opportunity, because the only way a democracy can be a democracy is to be an egalitarian democracy. Only two slides to conclude. Some readings, if you want, if you have time to lose. Eight readings. I suggest also an article, a very important article, written by David Forgatch, published in the Journal of Modern Italian Studies, about the Italian public sphere. Donatella della Porta, Can Democracy Be Saved? Leonardo Morlino, Change for Democracy, Russell Dalton and others, Political Parties and Democratic Linkage, and the Democratic Innovations are very recent books published at the end of 2014, written by Grant Smith, an English scholar, and three books in Italian, Democrazia Digitale by Emiliana De Blasio, Civic Engagement, Active Citizenship, Equality of Democracy. No, it's in Italian. Cittadinanza Attiva e Qualità della Democrazia, written by Giovanni Moro. And last, but you can avoid it, my book about the relationship between media and democracy. I know that I have been really long, maybe even boring. I hope not so much. But let me to show the last slide, which is only thank you. Thank you for your attention.
Can I like sound a skeptical or cynical note? I mean, I'm sorry to do this, but you're very positive about the possibility of a deliberative democracy, participatory, and so on. And you said this interesting thing about the Movimento Cinque Stelle, if I can just pick this up, or you probably know, most of you, that in the 2013 election, this new political formation got nearly, in fact, it got 26% of the share of the vote in the chamber, in the Camera dei Deputati. The other two parties, the other two coalitions, the centre-right and the centre-left, had about 29% each. So this new formation, you know, pretty much comes out of nowhere. It's a blog created by Beppe Grillo, a former television comedian. He builds a movement, and it is, you know, the third largest formation. And I think one of the things you said that's interesting is there is a difference between Beppe Grillo and the Movimento Cinque Stelle, the M5S. You know, the Beppe Grillo is a kind of top-down demagogic politician, you know, who kind of works vertically, and the Movimento is a horizontal model, which you didn't say sort of pop up there with, you know, Tsipras and, you know, Syriza, but it's, you know, it's a more kind of horizontal system. My connection with Italian kind of grassroots politics sees some of what you're talking about at local level, but I don't see signs of a kind of mass participatory movement emerging. And in fact, I feel rather pessimistic about the possibility of that breaking the model that there is now. I don't see a kind of burgeoning, you know, another 68 or another 77 or another, you know, Syriza, or, you know, what happened in Greece, or what's happening with Podemos happening in Italy. So do you see signs that that actually might happen? It would be great if it would be happening, but I don't see it, and I tend perhaps to see more the other side of your picture, which is the rise of presidentialism, the disappearance of parties, intermediary structures, you know, the lack of what used to be, but not the emergence of a really new positive alternative. So I don't know if you want to come back on that, or if you want to take some more questions first, but that's, you know, how positive and optimistic can we really be about this?
To answer to the David Fogger's questions, I think we need another lecture, so 35, 40 minutes? No, okay. There are many questions you have touched. First, five-star movements. It's a very interesting case, because five-star movements is not a traditional party. In the five-star movements coexist two different movements. The top-down movements, as you say, in the Beppe Grillo's blog, and a movement clearly and strongly led by Beppe Grillo e Casaleggio, and it's a movement that I have defined as stratarchical, which means very horizontal at the local level, which power diffused, so not concentrated, but in the same time a very hierarchically based power from Beppe Grillo and Casaleggio and the militants and the activists and the representative in the parliament, the member of parliament. It's very strange, because the five-star movements, the electorate of five-star movements is composed by different constituencies. The first one is represented by the grassroots movements, such as, for example, the Movimenti per la Decrescita, or, for example, the movement for the environment, and movement of the radical left, and so on. This is the first constituency of the electorate. The second constituency is represented by the people who usually don't vote. Person who have lost their credibility in their trust in political parties, in traditional political parties, and in Italian politics. And they have found in Beppe Grillo and his movement an exercise, a tool to express a rage against the power, against the political power. The third constituency is represented by the so-called Grillini, which are the followers of the blog, essentially, which are the persons who have subscribed to the blog and that have the possibility to vote. So it's a very strange movement, because the meetup are horizontally organized, and they use a participatory system to elaborate discussions and to find proposals for public policies. But in the same time, there is a dirigistic organization led by Beppe Grillo, and another part of the movement, which is the member of parliaments. So in this sense, I don't consider the five-star movement a representation of deliberative and participatory democracy, for two reasons. The first one is that they use direct democracy in the bloc. It's an exogenous procedure. Two or three proposals, and you have to vote for or against. It's very different from what the movement, the ground of the movement does using the digital platforms in discussing public policies at the local level. The meetup, for example, uses iResis, which is a digital platform developed by some militants of five-star movements, which is even more flexible than the more famous liquid feedback. So it's very interesting because that is a very important deliberative and participatory action, but at the same time, the party's action in the public sphere is absolutely traditional. There is a leader, there is a parliament, the member of parliaments, there is a strategic asset to follow. I think that a real example of a political party which has used a deliberative method is only in for among that the those I know, Podemos in Spain, because Podemos has used a deliberative method to discuss and elaborate its program. Podemos has used a sort of strange primaries election using the digital platforms. So not only primaries election in which people can vote for a candidate, but also in which people can discuss the candidates. Different from the US tradition or from the recent Italian tradition used by the Democratic Party. This is the first point. So five-star movements is an exception, is a case to study, is a very important for the willingness of participation that has exploded with the movement, but it, in the same time, is institutionalization has been a failure, in my opinion. Other questions about the local level and the national level. In Italy, we have a lot of some very interesting experiences at the local level. The Tuscany region law for democratic participation, for example, that I've cited before, it's one of the most advanced and important law to improve and increase the democratic participation, the people's participation, not only in Italy, but probably in Europe. But in the same time, this law is few applied, few used, and it's a regional law. It's not a national law. And so this is another point of conflict in Italy. The local level is very participatory. The national level is absolutely hierarchically based. I don't think I'm not optimist. I have a realistic option. You know that I don't like pessimistic vision, but I don't like neither optimistic vision. I prefer a realistic vision in the following Antonio Gramsci's visions of society, of Italian society. I think that we have some opportunities coming from the so-called dialogic democracy. I think that a local level based upon deliberative and participatory democracy can have an intersection with the national level. I don't think that deliberative democracy can replace the representative institutions. I think it's absolutely impossible in the modern states. And it is absolutely impossible in a globalized world. I think that it's still necessary to have institutional organization and elective assemblies. But in the same time, we can put together the local level and the national level. Probably we can use some of the ideas that the Scottish government is proposing in this month about civic participation in local level, in municipalities and city councils and so on, which intersect the national level. This is very interesting because the Scottish Parliament is probably the most participatory elective institution in Europe, because it has an integrated system with local levels. And I think that it can be a way to follow. Third question, because there is a third question about the future. I think that the present situation, the present Italian situation, is terrible. Okay. For many reasons. The first one is the absence of grassroots national movements. Yes, you're right. Podemos has decreted the death of the social movements, because all the social movements are now in Podemos. So in Spain there are no longer social movements such as the Indignados and so on. But they have a political party, which is very strong and which is given in the polls as the first or second political parties in Spain. In Italy, we have nothing similar because we have a participatory local level. Social movements are at local levels, but not national movements. And I think that we will not have any social movements at national level in the next years, even because these electoral and institutional reforms can put Italy into a new diminished democracy. I try to explain. I absolutely agree with the change of prerogatives of one of the two chambers. But the law, which is at the moment in discussion in the parliament, previews that the second chamber, the Senate, il Senato, must become a sort of club of the bridge or something similar for the elected, who has no important power in their assemblies. So a chamber composed by senators who will not have any importance nor power to control, to check the government or the other chamber. So it's absolutely unuseful. In the same time, the Italicum law is, in my opinion, very dangerous because the 75% of the elected representatives will be nominees, will be nominated by the leaders. Only 25, 24, 25% will be directly elected by the people. This is a problem for our democracy. In this context, it's very difficult, in my opinion, that new social movements can rise up and new political parties can rise up because there are no political spaces. It's impossible to have the force to clash against the new law, the new electoral law. So I think that we could have a parliament in which our political parties with 25, 28, 30% of share can govern the country. This is not majoritarian. This is a trick. And in the same time, this makes impossible for the rising up of new political parties. Example, Landini doesn't spoke of political party because he knows that there is no political space for a new political party in this moment in Italy. For this reason, he defines movements, social space, social action, social proposal, but not political party, because probably there is no space for another political party in this moment in Italy. So the strange situation is that wake democracy, like the democracy of Spain, has been capable of to have a renovation. the Greece democracy too. I don't know very well the Greek situation. While the Italian democracy continue to be blocked for several years, it is not new in Italy, as you know, because Italy has been blocked for 40 years with the lack of alternatives when Christian Democrats governing and Communist Party was marginalized. And after this, we have had the 20 years of Berlusconian era, and now probably we will have another long era of a blocked system. I'm not so optimistic in my vision about Italy. I think that it is possible a dialogic democracy, but this term, I conclude, this term dialogic democracy is used by Andrew Dobson, for example, is an English scholar, a Londoner scholar, and I have used this expression in the same time when Dobson used it. Dialogic democracy means the juxtaposition of deliberative and participatory practices and electoral representative liberal systems. This juxtaposition is possible only in an interlocutive democracy, in a democracy in which the leaders are horizontal leaders, in which the leaders can raise up from the people, in which they emerge from a popular consensus and not like a sort of Weberian model of leadership in as happened in Italy with Silvio Berlusconi and probably in different very different situation with Matteo Renzi. I think about, for example, Nicola Sturgeon, the first minister of Scotland, and first of all, Alex Salmond. They are typical examples of horizontal figures, horizontal leaders, not transactional leaders, not transformational leaders. They are dialogic leaders. Massimo. I think that it's very difficult for Italy to have a dialogic leaders. Probably also for the history of Italy, for the Italian culture. David Forgat has written a lot of books about Italian culture, and you know that Italian culture is responsible for this lack of democratic shift towards a more participatory democracy. Thank you. Thank you.